Hello, this is Kathy Nichols, and I am pleased to welcome your team to the Lake Superior Quality Innovation Network, or LSQIN, National Nursing Home Quality Care Collaborative's Learning Session 1. This is the fourth and final webinar for Learning Session 1. We hope that you have enjoyed the webinars and activities intended to assist your team in your quality improvement efforts and creating a quality culture within your organization. The first webinar in the series discussed what is meant by quality culture and strategies for creating one in your organization. As a team, you reviewed your mission and values and discussed the quality culture in your home. You were then asked to pick a strategy from the change package to work on. The second webinar discussed choosing a performance improvement project, or PIP, based on your organization's data and shared additional tools to assist with that process. The third webinar discussed setting goals and how to use the goal-setting worksheet to assist your team. You were then asked to establish a goal for a performance improvement project. In this webinar, I'll discuss how creating measures helps you evaluate whether the PIP is accomplishing what was intended. The objectives for this webinar, we will focus on how we think about and create measures for performance improvement projects. One of the strategies of high-performing nursing homes found in the change package is to be a continuous learning organization. A culture that supports quality is one that knows when and how to change by using data to drive performance. For each PIP, identify process and outcome measures to assist changes and monitor them to see if they're resulting in an improvement. The Institute for Healthcare Improvement uses the Model for Improvement as the framework to guide improvement work. The Model for Improvement is a simple yet powerful framework for any initiative. The first step is to pick a focus area and then answer the first question, what are we trying to accomplish? This is where you define the problem and set the goal. Once you have defined what you're trying to accomplish, it's time to think about how you will know whether or not the changes you will make is an improvement. Remember that you can make many changes without improving anything. This is where measurement helps you. Measurement is an essential component in helping an organization determine, did the implemented interventions or actions lead to an improvement? Were the interventions implemented as we expected? Did the implemented changes or actions lead to the expected outcomes? Have the changes been sustained? And are they embedded into staff practice as we expected? Have the changes resulted in improvement in care and services over time? And how do the outcomes compare to and benchmark against performance at state and national levels? How will we know that change is an improvement? We must have data. As William Deming, considered to be the father of modern quality, stated, to achieve the highest level of performance requires more than a good philosophy. The organization must change its behavior and adopt new ways of doing business. We can't trust it will be better. We must collect data and measure to know. So let's focus on measurement. There are three types of measures we use to help us define what to measure to show success or improvement. Structural measures, which apply to physical equipment or facilities. Process measures, which tell us if the process is occurring as we intended. And outcome measures, which address the final product or results. You'll often find that the structural measures and process measures may be the easiest to measure, but it's often said that outcome measures are ultimately the most important. Let's look at each of these measures in more detail. Structural measures are related to the changes in the physical aspects of the environment or related to equipment. Let's take a PIP project on making the environment more accessible. One of the interventions is to change the door handles throughout the building so doors are easier to open. A need to monitor a permanent structural change, like changing door hardware, isn't needed. Once the new handles are installed, you don't have to monitor that they're still there. However, monitoring whether the structural change is providing the intended outcome is important, So auditing through observation, interviews, or surveys is a good idea. What we want to know is that people have an easier time opening and passing through the doorway after the new hardware is installed. Process measures assess the steps or activities carried out in order to deliver care or services. A process measure evaluates whether the appropriate work steps have taken place. These are usually work steps or actions taken by staff. For example, consistent use of an SBAR tool. Process measures are used to indicate whether a change has been embedded into practice and sustained as expected. Sources of data for process measures can be observational audits, chart reviews, surveys, and so forth. Process measures must be logically linked to the outcome or what you're trying to accomplish. Process measures help you to determine if the intervention you have put into place or the change you have made is happening as you expect it to. Process measures are very important because just drawing attention to an issue or a problem can result in a temporary improvement in the outcome. This may lead you to think the improvement is because of a change that was put in place and you declare victory. Unfortunately, the outcome will likely not be sustained over time, and you will be left thinking the intervention was not successful when, actually, it was never implemented. Process measures are important to prevent this from happening and can also help you determine if the process is able to be followed or sustained over time. Consideration should be given to sample sizes for denominators, exclusion criteria, and alternative processes or workarounds that may exist. You'll likely have more process measures than outcome measures in a project. There are process measures at the project level and process measures associated with each PDSA cycle. Outcome measures focus on the product or the outcome of a process or system of care or services. Ideally, every action plan has a structural or process measure as well as an outcome measure. Outcome measures provide information on whether the implemented action plan achieved the attendant goal. For example, is the individual safer? Has better care been provided? Have further problems been avoided? Sources of outcome measures can be data that is monitored as part of an organization's quality or safety program, including items like incident reports, chart reviews, satisfaction surveys, MDS data, or QM or QI reports. Process measure data collected and monitored over time identifies if the change has been sustained. Used alone, a process measure will not describe the impact the action plan had on preventing another incident. Using both process and outcome measures allows an organization to analyze whether the change has occurred and to know whether it has changed the system and will prevent recurring incidents. Using only one type of measure gives only part of the story. The lack of a recurrence of the event or the outcome measure could be coincidental and not attributed to the process change. Defining the numerator and denominator. Once the problem and the interventions to make changes are identified, measures to monitor the progress of the action plan must be created. Effective measures will demonstrate if the change in the structure or process has occurred and if the changes made are having an effect on improving the outcome. A measurement should be defined for each action identified in the action plan. In this example, the numerator is the number of therapy appointments that were scheduled and missed in the post-acute unit in the past month, and the number is 25. Process measures are usually calculated by counting the number of cases or number of times a process occurs, which is the numerator, and dividing it by the number of cases in which the problem or process could have occurred, which is the denominator. The calculated rate is usually expressed as a percentage. For example, a numerator of 15 and a denominator of 30 is expressed as 50%. Outcome measures are calculated in a similar fashion, but instead count the number of times the problem or outcome occurs, which is the numerator, and divide by the number of times the event could have occurred, which is the denominator. Both the numerator and the denominator should be carefully defined to include only the cases to be counted in the numerator, and those cases with the opportunity for the problem to occur in the denominator. Whatever is expected to be measured must be very clear. Is it all medication errors, or just medication errors involving anticoagulants? Choose the numerator and denominator accordingly. Here's an example of the denominator for tracking the therapy appointment, and that's the total number scheduled in the past month. Another example would be finding out the extent the electronic health record has been implemented across the organization. The numerator would equal the number of departments with the implemented electronic health record, and the denominator would be the number of all departments in the organization. Next, you should look for any exclusions. Are there any persons or events that would be excluded from your total count? In this example of missed therapy appointments, it would exclude any residents that had been admitted to the post-acute unit less than 24 hours. After defining the numerator, the denominator, and any exclusions, you do the math. 25 missed therapy appointments divided by the total number of therapy appointments in a month times 100 equals 12.5%. So 12.5% of the scheduled therapy appointments were missed in a month's time period. This would be the baseline. A measure goal is a level of expected compliance or outcome with a planned action and usually is expressed as a percentage. A goal should be identified for each measure created for the action plan. Goals should be written in the SMART format: specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and timely. For example, the number of missed therapy appointments per month on the post-acute unit will be 5% or less by January 1st, 2016. While a goal is the level of expected compliance with the planned action, a threshold is the minimum acceptable level of performance for that action, the level below which the planned action hasn't been adopted as expected. If the measure falls below the threshold, additional action is needed to increase compliance. We need to develop a better process, or we need to change the process. Consistently falling below a threshold indicates that a process change has not been embedded and sustained as expected, and that continuing with the same approach isn't going to be effective. Like a goal, a threshold usually is expressed as a percentage rate. If the process change is thought to be a critical component within the system related to the event, meaning its failure is highly likely to result in another event, the threshold may be the same as the goal. For example, failure of hourly rounding by nursing assistants is highly likely to lead to another high-risk fall. In this case, a high threshold should be set. In contrast, failure to document daily skin inspections as part of the safe skin procedure in a limited number of instances may be less likely to lead to another pressure ulcer developing by itself. In this case, the threshold could be set lower. Though both processes are important and should be done consistently, the first example may leave less room for error and may be more likely to result in another event if not completed every time. In this example, the threshold is when the percentage of missed therapy appointments reaches 10% or above. Thank you for your attention on how to create measures for performance improvement projects. This is the last webinar of Learning Session 1. There will be an open call on June 9th. Please go to the LSQIN website for more information. We hope you have found these webinars and activities helpful for your team. You will receive an evaluation form after June 9th. We're anxious to hear how this format worked for your team. Once you've completed it, you will receive a certificate of participation. For questions about this webinar or about Learning Session 1, please contact your state lead in the Lake Superior Quality Innovation Network. Thank you for your participation.